Are you new to the topic of Planet X and feeling overwhelmed and somewhat unnerved? And while you may reject the concept, you have a sense of an internal knowing that propels you forward. So you try to become informed, but sorting through alarmist headlines, fear-charged rhetoric, and dubious content is dispiriting. Consequently, you're not sure what to believe. And if you sense that this is not a coincidence, you're absolutely right. Nonetheless, some of you lay awake at night, staring at the ceiling, reluctant to fall asleep, only to have that god-awful dream once again. You know the one. It's real, it's vivid, and so troubling, you dread falling asleep. Or was it just as simple as asking yourself, what exactly am I looking at, only to have the question rip the blinders off your head and you no longer enjoy the bliss of ignorance? No matter how you got to this point, it's an unsettling place to be. And what you want and need now is peace of mind. The first step to achieving that is to understand exactly what we're up against. This is because most of us instinctively understand that long after the beans, bullets, and bunkers have played out, the good folks who make it to the backside when we see those beautiful blue skies again will need something more to keep them going. That's why surviving what is to come is not about preparing against what you fear. Rather, it is preparing for what you love. Because holding on to each other is far more important than holding on to things. To help you prepare for what you love, this program gives you the who, what, when, where, why, and how about Planet X. The goal here is to help you gain confidence in your own ability to get a good bead on things. So let's take a look ahead at what you'll see in this program. For starters, we'll look at all the different names used for Planet X and what the term actually means. Then we'll take on the debunker rant that Planet X is an internet hoax. With a first-of-its-kind, broad-brush, chronological view of Planet X history from 1781 to the present. This is because the only truth that matters is the truth that you put inside yourself, in your own time and in your own way. Follow this path to knowledge, and you will find the sense of self you need to survive the years ahead with love and hope for the future. So let's get started. The term Planet X was coined by the American astronomer Percival Lowell sometime between 1905 and 1908. It describes an unobserved planet that perturbs the orbit of a known planet. A perturbation is a deviation in a planet's orbit, and the Planet X we're searching for is Neptune's perturber, which, like Neptune, orbits our Sun. For this reason, Planet X is described in ancient wisdom texts and folklore from around the world as Marduk, Frightener, Destroyer, Hercobalus, Nibiru, and more. So is Planet X really nothing more than an internet hoax perpetrated by panic-for-profit fear-mongers, as debunkers claim? Or is there more to it than that? There is. And it begins in 18th century Europe. On March 13, 1781, William Herschel discovered Uranus, making it the first planet to be discovered with a telescope. Following his discovery, European astronomers turned their attention on Uranus and observed perturbations in its orbit. This discovery would eventually launch the search for Planet X. If one were to choose the father of Planet X research, it would have to be Alexis Bouvard, a French astronomer who observed the perturbations in the orbit of Uranus and attributed them to the existence of an unknown planet, the first Planet X. Unfortunately, Bouvard died before the coordinates for Neptune could be mathematically determined by French mathematician Urbain Le Verrier and British mathematician John Couch Adams, using Bouvard's observations. Verrier gets the official credit because he relayed those coordinates to astronomer John Gall of the Berlin Observatory, and 5 days later, Neptune was observed by Gall on September 23, 1846. This made Neptune the first planet to be discovered by a mathematical prediction. So Neptune was also the first Planet X to be discovered. But subsequent calculations based on the orbits of Uranus and Neptune indicated the presence of yet another Planet X well beyond the orbit of Neptune. And so the search resumed. Not in Europe, but in America. The Lowell Observatory was established in 1894 in Flagstaff, Arizona, by Percival Lawrence Lowell, an independent businessman, mathematician, and astronomer. One reason Lowell founded the observatory was to study the planet Mars and its canals. The other was the search for other objects of interest in our solar system, most particularly Neptune's perturber, Planet X. A fact that revisionist historians downplay or paint over. Yet, it was Lowell's intention to find the mysterious Planet X that led to the discovery of Pluto. In 1929, 14 years after Lowell's death, a young astronomer by the name of Clyde W. Tombaugh was retained by the Lowell Observatory to carry on the search for Planet X. And on February 18, 1930, he discovered Pluto. At the time, astronomers believed he had found Planet X, Neptune's perturber. Consequently, the topic of Planet X languished for some time after Tombaugh's discovery. However, after the discovery of Pluto's moon Charon in 1978, it was determined that Pluto lacked the mass to be Neptune's perturber, as it is only about 60% the size of our own moon. So with that, the search for Planet X was once again afoot. It's also interesting to note that Pluto was later demoted to the status of a dwarf planet in 2006 by the International Astronomical Union. In 1950, Emanuel Velikovsky published Worlds in Collision, and he was viciously attacked by mainstream science, even though he corresponded frequently with Albert Einstein. What generated this medieval response from modern science is that Velikovsky used ancient accounts to question the Darwinian notion of evolution with evidence of periodic cataclysms caused by large objects flying through the core of our solar system. Despite ruthless suppression, Velikovsky's work reawakened an open discussion of Planet X, and following that, a steady trickle of interest emerged, both in mainstream science and the media. On March 3, 1972, NASA launched the Pioneer 10 spacecraft to explore the outer planets. However, according to government whistleblowers, the real purpose was to find Planet X, or at least to help narrow down the search field. An interesting aspect of Pioneer 10 is that it also carried a small gold anodized aluminum plaque designed by astronomer Carl Sagan, should the spacecraft be found by extraterrestrials. At present, communication with the Pioneer 10 spacecraft is no longer possible. Following the launch of Pioneer 10, the topic of Planet X would have languished again had it not been for Zachariah Sitchin, the author of The 12th Planet, which was first published in 1976. According to his translations of ancient Sumerian texts, a race of beings living on a planet called Nibiru bioengineered early hominids on Earth to turn them into slaves for the purpose of mining gold. Called the Anunnaki, these beings lived on a planet the Sumerians called Nibiru, what we call Planet X today. And the Sumerian accounts tell us that it orbits our sun every 3,600 years and flies through the core of our system, often causing great cataclysms on Earth. Sitchin's translations and theories are corroborated by an ancient wisdom text called the Colburn Bible. And according to Planet X historian Greg Jenner in his book, Planet X and the Colburn Bible Connection, previous flybys of this mysterious object caused the sinking of Atlantis, the deluge, and the 10 plagues of Exodus. Although Sitchin was continuously mocked and attacked by fundamentalists, our government took his work seriously, and on January 25, 1983, NASA launched the Infrared Astronomical Satellite, IRAS. Its mission was to map the sky using infrared. According to NASA, IRAS was unable to complete its mission due to a failure in its supercooling system, and much of the data collected from the probe was classified and has never been disclosed. Several government whistleblowers say that this was a cover-up because NASA shut down IRAS after it imaged Planet X. Their accounts parallel an article published by the New York Times on January 30, 1983, shortly after the IRAS launch. Evidence assembled in recent years has led several groups of astronomers to renew the search for the 10th planet. They are devoting more time to visual observations with the 200-inch telescope at Mount Palomar in California. They are tracking two Pioneer spacecraft, now approaching the orbit of distant Pluto, to see if variations in their trajectories provide clues to the source of the mysterious force. And they are hoping that a satellite-borne telescope launched last week will detect heat signatures from the planet, or whatever it is out there. It is important to note that the term Planet X was also used to refer to a 10th planet. However, after Pluto was demoted to a dwarf planet in 2006, that definition became irrelevant. But what is relevant is what IRAS imaged and the consequences of those observations. In a Victoria Advocate article published on June 14, 1988, NASA astronomer Dr. John D. Anderson was quoted as saying that telemetry from the Pioneer 10 spacecraft indicated the existence of Planet X. Also note that this article was sourced from Google News and was featured in Yowza.com's March 2012 article titled The Planet X Cover-Up in the Mainstream Media. Following publication of our article, the entire June 14, 1988 edition was deleted from the Google News site. However, a complete copy is available for Yowza.com subscribers. But what is relevant here is that Anderson is a NASA astronomer with one heck of a resume, and what he said in that 1988 news article was powerful. In that article, he said, "We have a 90 to 99% confidence that Uranus and Neptune are being disturbed, and by one candidate for that is a single planet X." At that point, our government became more interested in keeping public attention focused much closer to home. After all, if you can't see it, it's not there. So go back to sleep, America. Nothing to see here. However, a few curious minds had other notions. On October 1988, Dr. Robert S. Harrington, the chief astronomer for the U.S. Naval Observatory, published his paper, "The Location of Planet X," in the Astronomical Journal. In an August 30, 1990 television interview with Zachariah Sitchin, Harrington also said that Pluto had been a satellite of Neptune, but it was dislodged by Planet X, which he believed could possibly sustain some form of life. He also showed Sitchin a diagram he had created approximating the location of Planet X. Following that interview, Harrington commissioned the construction of a special telescope for a Planet X photographic sky survey in 1991, which was completed at the Black Birch Observatory in New Zealand. The New Zealand observations were performed using Harrington's calculations, and the results were sent to NASA. However, those films vanished and have never been seen again, which leaves us with a big question. Did Harrington actually find Planet X, Neptune's perturber? In 1992, Sitchin produced a documentary titled, "Are We Alone in the Universe?" At the end of that film, Sitchin quotes a NASA press release from that same year. "Unexplained deviations in the orbits of Uranus and Neptune point to a large outer body system of 4 to 8 Earth masses on a highly tilted orbit 7 billion miles from the Sun." This NASA press release suggests that Harrington did find Planet X in 1991, but the truth will never be known, because before he could publish his findings, Harrington died from a rapid onset of esophageal cancer on January 23, 1993. With his New Zealand findings suppressed and having died before he could publish his findings, many believe he was assassinated. One of the reasons given by those who subscribe to the theory of an assassination was an obituary by Charles E. Worley of the U.S. Naval Observatory. Worley wrote an obituary about Harrington that states, "Late in his career, Bob seemed quite skeptical of such an object, however." It is important to note that no other sources have come forward to corroborate Worley's claim. Consequently, Harrington's mysterious death was a shot out of the dark that quickly silenced the Planet X topic, both with the mainstream media and science community alike. In a very real sense, it was a veiled threat. Tamper with this at the risk of your own career, or perhaps even your life. In this regard, Worley's obituary was highly effective. This is for sure. Nonetheless, there is a curious question. Harrington built a custom telescope for a U.S. Naval Observatory station in New Zealand. The mission was simple: to find Planet X. So then, did they? Who knows? Because until NASA decides to declassify Harrington's observations, all we can say is that where there is smoke, there is fire. Meanwhile, we're not helpless either, and you'll see why later on in this program. But for now, if you are beginning to feel that the time has come to begin your own planning and preparation for whatever may come, then know this. When the worst of it hits, it will not be brief. This will not be weeks or months. Rather, we're looking at several years, perhaps longer than a decade. What this means is that your supplies, no matter how much you have on hand, is nothing more than a buffer. it buys you some time to work something else out. To optimize that opportunity of time, gather knowledge now, because after things run out, knowledge will help you to endure. And now, I'd like to share some of this very knowledge with you. It's something I've put a lot of work and love into because I know it will help people to make it to the backside. And that is what I'm all about. For those in preparation and planning, healthcare is always a problematic area because it is focused on the pills, potions, and supplements preppers set aside to help get themselves through a cataclysm. And it is problematic because all things physical play out. So a practical solution is what we call transition planning. So is this a December 21, 2012 solution? No. In our last video, Planet X System Observations and Orbital Path Analysis, we addressed December 21, 2012 as an awareness event. It was media-driven and it was successful in creating awareness, so on that regard, mission accomplished. Now, transition is the mission. Simply put, surviving the worst of times begins with surviving the best of times. So in this program, we want to introduce the core concept of transition planning. It is a four-stage survival resource rating system. Stage one is cataclysm awareness. This is when the mainstream media begins to seriously report the news to the public at large and panic buying ensues. If you're not prepared by this time, be ready for long lines and short supplies at the store. Stage two is cataclysm events. Simply put, the first to fall will most likely be the last to know. But planning and luck will also play equal roles. While planning and preparation is not a guarantee that you and your loved ones will survive these events, it will, however, dramatically increase your odds of survival. And with repeated events, expect all or part of your survival stores or caches to be exhausted, lost, or stolen. Stage 3 is post-event. Those who survive the cataclysm event will search for survivors and pull together into small, self-organized groups. While most preppers set aside enough for themselves and their loved ones, as a member of a larger survival group, you'll also share with them as well. This is when the bulk of your physical supplies will be used up. Stage 4 is the backside. This will be the time years into the future when those who survive all the worst that man and nature can throw at them live to see blue skies once again. By this time, all medical supplies will have long been exhausted, and what you'll have is knowledge. Of paramount importance will be the kind of knowledge that helps you with survival wellness and developing sustainable ways of growing food and medicinal herbs. This brings us to the simple metric of our transition planning system. It's a rating system. You rate your resources, physical and knowledge, in terms of how far they'll get you through the process. Here are a few examples. The internet is a fabulous stage one resource, but it likely will not go much further than that. A fire extinguisher is a handy stage two resource. Have one on hand. And off-road bicycles will be an ideal stage three resource for getting around when there's not much left in the way of roads. And long after the internet, fire extinguishers and off-road bicycles have rusted away, knowledge will continue to endure, especially survival knowledge like Donjon breathing. Donjon breathing was created by Korean ruling elites back in the early days of acupuncture. These people were not worried about dying from hunger or thirst. Rather, they lived in fear of catching a cold, hence the old expression, "Don't catch your death of cold." And to explain how it works, is Donjon Breathing for Wellness co-developer Master Rohr Shepard.
You want to have a tool that's been used for thousands of years to deal with these kind of situations. Dungeon breathing is easy to learn, quickly oxidizes the body, lets go of carbon dioxide waste, and lowers the calorie demand of the body. More oxidation in the body, less influence from communicable diseases. Now that's important.
The complete Dungeon Breathing for Wellness system from feelbetteronyourown.com includes a full-color symptoms handbook and 6 exercise and reference DVDs. This course was developed by preppers, for preppers, and the symptoms handbook is the core of the system. It offers quick access to poses for a wide range of symptoms and complaints. And it's designed to help volunteer trainers pass along these simple techniques to others. Each pose is cross-referenced by skill level, symptom, and personal goals. Organized into 3 levels, low impact, universal, and high impact, the 57 core poses offered in the Feel Better on Your Own system represent those used by Korean elites for centuries. They are simple, practical, and highly effective. To learn more, visit feelbetteronyourown.com today and view our free instruction videos. Imagine that you knew about the stock market crash of 1929 well in advance of the common man. Obviously, you could use such advanced knowledge to reap windfall profits from the misery. That is, assuming you were to keep the knowledge a secret. So, to what lengths would you go to keep future victims in the dark so that you could achieve the full measure of your own self-interested goals? Likewise, would you expect elites to rise above their own compulsions for power and wealth for moral or ethical purposes to inform the public at large, even if you are not so inclined? The point here is that for the elites, the topic of Planet X has always been about the leverage of deception, because of something I call Titanic rules. First class gets the boats, and steerage goes down with the ship. We're steerage, and the best we can do is to muster an occasional glimpse through a foggy porthole before the elites close it. Yes, it's unfair, but it has always been that way, and each day you spend agonizing over this is one less day you're focused on what really matters, your survival and that of those for whom you love and care. Keep this in mind as we present excerpts from observation reports. On April 24, 2006, Yowza.com broke the story on the South Pole Telescope, SPT, in Antarctica. The stated mission for the SPT really doesn't make a lot of sense because the same science could be done somewhere else at a fraction of the cost. So why build an expensive and sophisticated infrared telescope in such an inhospitable and inaccessible location as the Amundsen Scott South Pole Station in Antarctica? The answer is simple. This infrared 10-meter dish is the perfect instrument for observing an object rising up through the southern skies in infrared. And once they turned it on in January 2007, that's exactly what happened. A year after the SPT went online, the first of 3 highly credible disclosure videos were published on YouTube. The first, posted by Nibiru Shock 2012, was titled Nibiru Planet X Photos Taken January 2008. It was the first time the public had an opportunity to see an image of Planet X in deep space. And here you see a capture from the video, and the same capture again, but enhanced. In it, we see not just one object, but several. This is when we first learned that Planet X is actually a mini constellation of planets and moons, orbiting a small brown dwarf star that is the binary twin to our own sun. Those of you who were in high school and college during the 1970s may remember this second sun as Nemesis, the designation used by professional astronomers of the day to discuss the possibility that we live in a binary star system. Also, just as Sitchin and Harrington predicted, it would be rising up from the southern skies. But we wondered, could lightning strike twice with another disclosure video? On March 3, 2008, Nibiru Shock posted his second video titled Nibiru Planet X Update February 1, 2008. Well, what do you know, lightning did strike twice. And in that video, we're told that Nibiru is now inside the Kuiper Belt, well beyond the orbit of Pluto. In this video, he tells us it is entering our system at an extremely shallow angle. This is consistent with our most current findings. In this second video, Nibiru Shock 2012 gave us a brilliant series of images that clearly show Planet X is a rather substantial mini-constellation of planets and moons orbiting a brown dwarf star that is in turn orbiting our own sun. Consequently, it does not look or move like anything humans have seen in over 3,600 years. He also told us that governments are afraid of a panic. Perhaps. But then again, remember Titanic rules. First class gets the boats, and steerage goes down with the ship. We're steerage. Why do we say this? Because after these two videos were posted, the Nibiru Shock 2012 channel was hijacked by disinformationalists, and the first two videos were labeled a hoax, and the channel was also corrupted. Having investigated the first two Nibiru Shock 2012 videos at length, we published our findings on April 6, 2008, in an article titled First Two Planet X SPT Leaked Image Videos by Nibiru Shock 2012, now seen as highly credible. The reason we drew this conclusion was that these were very impressive disclosures, but the manner in which the channel was attacked showed clear evidence of a well-organized and well-funded use of disinformation tradecraft. Following publication of our report, Yowza.com came under heavy attack. Our site was hacked, and a slander campaign was leveled against us with brutal vitriol. In the process of defending ourselves, we filed DMCA complaints with YouTube, and to their credit, Google removed over 13 different attack videos and terminated 4 disinformation channel accounts. Then on May 29, 2008, we published an update article titled Planet X Nibiru SPT Disclosures May 2008 Report. In it, we presented our analysis of a third SPT disclosure video by a different YouTuber going by the name of DNIR4808N. This YouTuber described how a personal friend working at the SPT had sent him an image of the Planet X system captured by the SPT on May 14, 2008. In the video, DNIR4808N named his friend, and the government had the YouTube channel removed along with this video within a few hours after it was posted. Thanks to an anonymous tip, we were able to download the video before the channel disappeared. The video was authentic, but the manner in which the channel was taken down was clear proof of further government suppression. And when you compare the images in the DNIR4808N video with the Nibiru Shock 2012 videos, it's obvious that both are of the same object or series of objects, which also happened to be in the southern skies. At that point, the question for our team was simple. How did these three SPT disclosure videos compare with Dr. Harrington's paper, The Location of Planet X, published in October 1988, and with the illustration he showed Zachariah Sitchin in a 1990 television interview? Luckily for us, the answer came a few months later. Corroboration for Harrington's calculations finally came in 2008 with the last polar flyby of the Sun by the ESA-NASA Ulysses probe. Although NASA says that the spacecraft failed before critical data could be gathered in its last orbit around the southern hemisphere of our Sun, it nonetheless yielded valuable data, and we published that on October 13, 2008, with an article titled "The ESA-NASA Ulysses Probe and Planet X Nibiru." The probe data is clear. The Sun's southern hemisphere is noticeably more active than its northern hemisphere. Also of interest is where the peak solar winds originate and the direction in which they're pointed. Our team continued researching Harrington's paper and the many disclosure videos we'd seen. Finally, on September 7, 2010, we published our findings in an article with a video titled "The Only Three Authentic SPT Disclosure Videos of 2008. Simply put, the three videos we discussed in this program by Nibiru Shock 2012 and DNIR 4808N are the real deal. What wasn't a real deal as predictions go was Comet Elenin. And we first raised that question in an article we published on May 15, 2011, titled, "Is Comet Elenin a Decoy?" After a lot of speculation, the result here is that sometimes a comet is just a comet. However, Comet Elenin was a ripe opportunity for organized distraction. Consequently, it was portrayed as Planet X, the nemesis dark star astronomers debated in the 70s, the Star of Bethlehem to herald the Second Coming, and an alien mothership under intelligent control. As it turns out, the only thing under intelligent control was the disinformation. So the next time you see a stampede in progress, you might want to keep this in mind. On July 30, 2012, a YouTube channel of anonymous amateur astronomers, the 00 Skyview, posted a video titled "What Begins in Aquarius Ends in Aquarius." One of the first things we noticed was that this group of folks were showing us their instrumentation. Now that was something new. Then they showed us where they found their object of interest, 4 degrees below the ecliptic. Plus, like the SPT disclosure videos, this group is showing us images of a mini constellation with a large object in the center and a cluster of satellites in orbit around it. But what really got our attention was that they were observing a red iron dust cloud, the hallmark signature of a brown dwarf star. Then on November 1, 2012, the 00 Skyview team upped the ante with a video titled "Lifting the Veil." Right out the gate, they predicted a greatest eastern elongation flyby approaching from the southern skies. Not a good thing. In astronomy, a greatest eastern elongation describes an object that passes us on our side of the Sun to the left of us and inside our own orbit. In this case, this object is also rising up from our southern skies. And it's interesting to compare the ESA-NASA Ulysses probe data with the 00 Skyview flyby prediction. They then presented an orbit for their object of interest, which also happens to resemble the orbit Dr. Robert S. Harrington showed in August 30, 1990, during a television interview with Zachariah Sitchin. Next, the 00 Skyview team presented a series of color-shifted variations and a wide-field view. However, their last image is of a mini-constellation in Aquarius, and it is similar to the mini-constellation in the January 2008 disclosure video by Nibiru Shock 2012 titled Nibiru Planet X photos taken January 2008. So were they seeing the same thing? Well, we must wait and watch, because this mini constellation moves through the sky like nothing we've ever seen before. However, what we can say is that when it does appear for all to see, it will appear suddenly. And given the observations for 2013 you're about to see, the need to plan and prepare for whatever may come is more important than ever before. But first, we want to acknowledge you ladies out there who've taken an interest in Planet X. When we published our first article in January 2002 on Planet X, women represented a 12% audience share. But in 2013, your ranks have grown to nearly three times that. And we want to thank you intrepid ladies out there because, well, the topic of Planet X is no longer a boys' club. With this in mind, I want to share helpful survival knowledge about dealing with a very ancient curse, both today and long after your medical kit is empty. Every self-healing energy art is about drawing energy and oxygen into the body. But only Dongjun breathing focuses on an area of the body women know as the womb, below the belly button and above the pelvis. It is why Dongjun breathing is so effective in helping to relieve the symptoms of menopause and PMS, as Master Roar Shepherd explains.
We energize that area, we heal that area, we bring oxygen right into that area. More oxygen, more healing, less pain. This is the most valuable tool for you.
Ladies, when drugs and treatments are no longer available and the medical kits are empty, what can you do? You do what Korean women have done for thousands of years, because it works. Dongjun breathing. Need relief today? The good news is, the sooner you start, the better. To learn more, visit feelbetteronyourown.com today and view our free instruction videos. At the beginning of January 2013, Yowza.com researchers began tracking an uncatalogued object using the Vulcan feed camera from the Turrialba volcano in Costa Rica. I dubbed the object Bluebonnet. With these observations, we began to see a pattern forming in terms of Planet X being a mini constellation instead of a single object. Though Bluebonnet is clearly not a brown dwarf companion to our own sun, its movement through the sky does raise the possibility that it could be a far-flung orbital of a second sun. On February 11, 2013, we published our findings in a video titled Object of Interest as Seen from the Turrialba Volcano. In this frame, you see Bluebonnet above the Turrialba volcano and specification data for the Vulcan feed. Turrialba is 10 degrees north of the equator at approximately 11,000 feet, and the Vulcan camera was pointed to the southwest with a good view of the Pacific Ocean on a clear day. In that video, we explain the difference between the horizon as we see it here on Earth and represented by the red line. The green line you see cutting through the center of the Sun is the ecliptic. The ecliptic is the plane of our solar system, and all of the planets orbit the Sun within a few degrees of it. This is important to know when analyzing a newly revealed and disturbing prediction by Nostradamus. In October 2007, the History Channel aired The Lost Book of Nostradamus for the first time. In this video, seven prophetic images paint a catastrophic end to life as we know it. According to this program, Nostradamus is showing us the constellation of Fucus because it will play a pivotal role in the flyby. This was interesting because the Vulcan feed image data also shows Bluebonnet transiting through or very near to the constellations Ophiuchus and Sagittarius in December of last year. Then on April 20th, 2013, we released an update video titled Blue Cachina and Its Moon for our Turrialba Object of Interest. In doing our research, we began developing a new technique to analyze the imaging capabilities of the Vulcan feed camera at Turrialba. We initially used this technique in a rather limited way, but it later evolved into a powerful image analysis method. Also noted in this update was a video released by the 00 Skyview team on March 23, 2013, titled The 5 Uploaded Images from the Dance of the Stars video. In that video, they provided a chart that gave us an interesting possibility for potential orbitals in the vicinity of Ophiuchus. Following months of observations and capturing hundreds of images to our database, we were able to plot a rough orbit for Bluebonnet, which we determined to be an outermost orbital of the Planet X system brown dwarf companion to our own Sun. Ergo, Bluebonnet does not orbit our Sun, but rather something else that does. We also looked at the predictions of remote viewer Major Ed Dames about these times and what the Colburn Bible tells us to expect. The first passage of Manuscripts 3-4 begins with, "When blood drops upon the earth, the destroyer will appear and mountains will open up and belch forth fire and ashes." This is a key passage, so let's take a moment to study it. "When blood drops upon the earth" refers to the iron dust cloud surrounding the Planet X system. "The destroyer will appear." What this tells us is that the iron dust cloud precedes the arrival of the destroyer, which in this case is Planet X, the ancient Hebrew and Egyptian description for this mini constellation. And the rest just doesn't get any better. On July 8, 2013, the 00 Skyview team posted a new video titled Fire in the Sky Part 3. The term KBO stands for Kuiper Belt Object, which is a classification for Planet X. Potential orbitals refers to the planets and moons in orbit around the KBO. And here they finally ask the question, is this our binary star? The reason they posted that question to the viewer is because they've observed a large nucleus for the KBO. But it was their second video on the 12th of that month titled A Cyclical Storm Brews that really got our attention. Near the end of the video, they announced that they've followed our Turrialba volcano research and the object I dubbed Bluebonnet. We then get a warm attaboy from the good folks at the 00 Skyview. Thank you, fellas. Your kind words of support were greatly appreciated, and we certainly hope to see you on the backside. Because you corroborated our observations of Bluebonnet, we were able to take a big step forward. On July 28, 2013, we posted our video, Planet X System Observations and Orbital Analysis, with featured observer Jorge Arena. Early on, an old debunking attack that Bluebonnet is a reflection because it appears in front of the Sun was disproved with a series of Vulcan feed captures. The series clearly shows Bluebonnet slipping behind the clouds. Also, the image analysis method we first introduced to our viewers in April was formalized and presented in detail. We call it Camera Sensor Illumination, CSI. And we used it to compare two Bluebonnet captures from this year, one from January and the other from May. Our CSI analysis shows that Bluebonnet has been growing larger and brighter. Likewise, CSI was used to evaluate the observation images of Jorge Arena. He is an importer of Peruvian foods and herbals, and he's based in Ontario, Canada. On May 27, 2013, while flying over the Eastern Pacific, he imaged the brown dwarf at the core of the Planet X system, while it appears at the Sun's 11 o'clock position relative to Earth's horizon. The actual placement relative to the ecliptic is below the ecliptic and near the Sun's 8 o'clock position. Also note that the Vulcan feed in Costa Rica is pointed towards the southwest at an elevation of approximately 11,000 feet, and that when Jorge took his picture, he was at 37,000 feet, and his camera was also pointed towards the southwest. And once again, we find an interesting connection between Jorge's observation and the 2008 ESA-NASA Ulysses probe data presented earlier. Using the data available on Bluebonnet plus Jorge's images, we were able to approximate the orbit of the Planet X mini-constellation through the core of our solar system. What this corroborates is the prediction of the 00 Skyview team that the Planet X flyby would happen on our side of the Sun in their November 1st, 2012 video titled Lifting the Veil. Further to that, in a September 2008 interview with Kerry Cassidy of Project Camelot, government whistleblower Bob Dean predicted the very same thing, that the Planet X flyby will occur when it is on our side of the Sun. And now, a moment of truth. Everything you've seen up to this point is intelligence. That is, a connected collection of fragments and shards of truth that happen to slip past years of suppression. But for those of you who insist on smoking gun proof, you're not going to believe anything until you've seen it yourself. That begs the question, what can you see today? What you can see are a lot of rocks coming our way. The American Meteor Society was founded in 1911 for meteor observations. It is a reliable source for information about meteors and fireballs. If you need to see things for yourself, visit www.amsmeteors.org and support the effort. But why would you want to do that? Because on February 15, 2013, NASA had all of us focused on the flyby of asteroid 2012 DA14. After weeks of media hype, the flyby turned out to be a rather boring non-event. Yet, on the very same day, the Chelyabinsk meteor airbursted over the southern Urals. It was the largest rock to hit our planet in over a century, and its detonation released the equivalent energy of over 20 Hiroshima bombs. It damaged over 7,000 buildings, and 500 people had to seek medical treatment for wounds. When pressed by the media for an explanation as to why NASA never saw it coming, they finally had to admit that they were blindsided by this meteor because it came out of the Sun and that they do not have any telescopes pointed in that direction. Still the same, can you imagine the carnage that would have occurred had this meteor airbursted over a major American city with the equivalent energy of over 20 Hiroshima atomic bombs? The point here is that we can continue to argue about what is happening here on Earth in a way that keeps the consensus out of reach. But when it comes to meteors, there are no more frivolous debunker theories about natural variation, increased reporting, and, well, swamp gas. Just consequences. That is why visiting the American Meteor Society, the AMS, is something you can do today to see what's coming at us. To show you why, we're going to show what people are seeing and reporting from 2010 through October 2013 based on AMS observation reporting data. Next, you will see our statistical analysis for the following fireball observation trends: the average number of reports per event, Number of reports by classification, multi-state event observations, fragmentation observations, events with sound reports, and finally a comparative trend summary that ties it all together. So let's begin. This series of slides shows the overall growth in the average number of reports per event for all classifications from January 1, 2010 to October 13, 2013. Of note is that in 2013, we see for the very first time in the history of AMS two fireball observations with over 1,000 reports each. So let's take a closer look at those reporting classifications. The AMS classifies meteor observations based on the number of reports per incident, where a mid-sized class event has 6 to 20 reports, a significant event has 21 to 50 reports, a large event has 51 to 100 reports, and a huge event has over 100 reports. So let's begin with a look at the mid-sized events. Here we see a pronounced jump from 2010 to 2011. Part of that jump can be attributed to the implementation of new reporting procedures by the AMS. Now let's add the number of significant reports with 21 to 50 observations each. Here we see a clear growth trend. Interestingly enough, there were no significant large events in 2010. But there were significant large events in 2011 and 2012, as well as a marked increase in 2013. In terms of huge events with over 100 reports, 2010 was barely noticeable. However, that picks up in 2011 and doubles in 2012, and then again in 2013. Given that we had two events with more than 1,000 observations in 2013, let's take a closer look at the uptick in huge events. Here we see the jump from 2011 to 2012, and then again to 2013, is stunning to say the least. Not only is the trend huge, so are the fireballs, or bolides as they are also called. So what's driving this trend? Multi-state observations. A multi-state event is where observations of the same fireball are reported in two or more states. And here we see a steady growth trend from 2010 to 2013. However, this underplays an even more profound change. Here we see a 15% increase from 2010 to 2013 in the number of reporting states by event. This clearly shows that these fireballs, or bolides if you will, are getting bigger. And another measure of this is fragmentation. Fragmentation is a key indicator of size. And while angle of attack and velocity also play a factor, the rule of thumb is the larger the meteor, the more likely it is to fragment, or break apart if you will. From 2011 through 2013, the number of meteors large enough to fragment skyrocketed according to AMS reporting data. This should be of real concern to all of us because this represents a 400% increase in just 3 years, and because there is a corresponding increase in sound as well. The AMS tracks two kinds of sounds. Concurrent sounds heard during the flyby, and delayed sounds heard just afterwards. These charts are a combination of both, and the trend is clear. Sound follows with fragmentation. And what is really striking is that sound and fragmentation reports for 2010 through 2013 show nearly identical increases. So now let's summarize what we've seen so far by looking at the growth trend percentages from 2010 to 2013. Now let's look at a big picture view of the AMS data based on the average number of observation reports per event, events with sound reports, fragmentation observations, and multi-state event observations. And what we see here, beginning with 2010, is a consistent growth trend by percentage from 2010 through to 2013. It is important to note that all of the data presented in this video is for the 2013 reporting period of January 1, 2013 to October 13, 2013, with 2.5 months yet to be reported. And for those of you who are still laboring with doubts about all of this, there is only one question you need to answer. What's throwing all these rocks at us? And what about those of you who no longer have any doubts about the need to plan and prepare for whatever may come? Do not plan against what you fear, but for what you love, because survival is not about holding on to things. It's about holding on to each other.
In this presentation, we have the Gabriel Nibiru star that's coming in towards the Earth and has been known to the astronomers since 1841. Via a shift in the orbits of the outer planets. Some magnetic force was causing that, and they assumed it was Planet X. We find, however, that the position that Gabriel Nibiru is going to take up is identified by the other nine planets, and we see an attempt to remove that from the knowledge of the Earth when the astronomers removed Pluto as being a star, reducing it from nine to eight. And now we've got Nibiru coming in, we'll bring it back up to nine. But Pluto, of course, is still there, which is 10 in total. So we see why, once we go through the slide, they did that. Blatantly obvious. As said, Nibiru is the Angel Gabriel. It was photographed by the infrared imaging satellite on October 21st, 2003. There are other reports, however, 50 years ago, of very clear photographs of the iron star coming in. The wings are iron atoms given off by the powerful magnetic field. It is molten iron. The planet is portrayed in an ancient Akanaki mural in Babylon, where the 10 planets plus the sun and moon, total 12, are depicted. We see from top left reading to the right, Neptune, Venus and Pluto, and you'll see the position distances from the sun in the center, which indicate that Mercury is in its right position, Venus is slightly further out, the Earth and Moon slightly further out. Then we have Nibiru, then Mars, and we have Saturn, of course, Jupiter and Uranus, all marked out clearly there. I've overlaid the Nibiru Gabriel in that position there to show that it's the counting from Mercury, the fourth out. Here's the actual photograph taken on the 21st of October 2003. In the next slide, the positions of the planets show the 12 spheres and the approaching Gabriel Nibiru, and how it will settle in between the Earth and Mars. And it has its own planetary system. Seven planets orbiting it are the seven angels of Revelation. So when you back engineer the book of Revelation, you can see that it is referring to Gabriel, who is the angel of God, because God has come to the earth. And as God has come to the earth, its angel follows. So the messengers are angels and stars. As said, Nibiru is the Angel Gabriel. It was photographed by the infrared imaging satellite on October 21st, 2003. There are other reports, however, 50 years ago of very clear photographs of the iron star coming in. The wings are iron atoms given off by the powerful magnetic field. It is molten iron. The planet is portrayed in an ancient Akanaki mural in Babylon, where the 10 planets plus the sun and moon, total 12, are depicted. We see from top left reading to the right, Neptune, Venus, and Pluto. And you'll see the position distances from the sun in the center, which indicate that Mercury is in its right position, Venus is slightly further out, the Earth and Moon slightly further out. Then we have Nibiru, then Mars, and we have Saturn, of course, Jupiter and Uranus, all marked out clearly there. Now, this is the principal reason why NASA built the Space Hubble, which immediately confirmed or rediscovered Planet X. Its space images so detailed, the race was on to build underground bunkers where the elite would go into hiding, leaving the rest of mankind to be burned alive by Nibiru. And I should add that they are also trying to ignite the surface of the Earth with a air bomb by releasing either a nuclear blast or bringing some asteroid in to hit the Earth to set off all the gas fracking that's been done in the United States and Australia, which would totally annihilate the Earth. There's also talk that they're trying to set off a nuclear bomb. And of course, when we look at the attempt that they made to give rockets armed with nuclear warheads to Iran, and they refused to take them. The idea was that they wanted to start a war with Israel, and the people in Israel, that don't matter at all to the ruling elite. They are not Jews anyhow, they just think they are. And the idea was to sacrifice them all anyhow. This is the idea of also of the double cross, the hands being crossed in the skull and bones tradition, and can be seen on the British flags when the ships sail back into port. They fly the skull and bones. So the crossed arms means double cross. You can double cross anybody and anything. So therefore, the Jews who think they are doing it for their God, Lucifer, will be double crossed anyhow, as will those above them, which are the Zionists that think that they can escape the coming judgment of God by going underground, yet they will be locked underground and burnt alive because Satan wants every human being dead, irregardless what they believe in and whether they think it is God or not. It wants to get rid of all of the creation of Yahweh. So what the government's failed to comprehend fully, that creation is all to do with numbers. However, their god Lucifer manipulates men to have their own ideas, while hidden from them, the devil, Lucifer, is a real angel that cannot exist on the earth as a being, but only as a spirit. This is evident in the Vedas of the Hindi religion. It tells of a story of how the fallen angels were allowed to come back to the earth after the flood. For prior to the flood, they were able to come as angels, and of course they then mated with women and produced this race of giants that had to be destroyed. So the angels were placed on the earth in human form as helps for mankind to educate man to realize man was created in the image of God Asherah Yahweh. They were to bring all races into paradise via the 12 tribes of Israel. They, the youngest race in all of the world, which were Hebrew. The fallen angels in human form mated with the women and produced offspring that were continually evil, taking the earth for themselves. And as I said, the flood was necessary to eliminate the evil. And when we go into the Hindu text, it shows that the raven flew off the ark and landed in Sri Lanka, Colombo. And if you go to India today, they will tell you that no man was ever supposed to occupy Colombo, Sri Lanka, because they would become infected by the demons. And this is actually what the case is today. We have the camel, is what they call themselves, that are creating all sorts of havoc throughout India. So with the return of Nibiru Gabriel after an absence of 3,600 plus years, it arrives back and will take up the orbital position, fulfilling the prophecy of the Book of Revelation. Being a manifestation of the angel of God, Gabriel, bringing seven angels, which are planets that will restore the earth to paradise. This is the pouring out of the seven vials of the seven angels, Book of Revelation. All things are prophecy or prophetic, proven by the numbers of creation. The planets are drawn northward towards the Milky Way galaxy equatorial line at 69,000 kilometers per hour. This causes the planets to orbit and rotate on their axis. Now, Nibiru Gabriel, with its seven planets, is a molten iron, highly magnetic miniature sun. So it will have to fall into a position where it will remain influencing the Earth, because this is where creation is, where all life is. And these are related to the planets via their position in an angular degree from the sun itself. So we are trailing behind the sun.
Which entered the atmosphere and then broke into several pieces, thereby turning into a meteorite. Happened about 9 o'clock in the morning, so all these people there were driving, you can see it right behind me. Imagine me driving to work, and then all of a sudden you see this absolutely tremendous flash.
It's war of the worlds, we're under attack.
Absolutely, and actually that's what a lot of people thought.
We're not under attack. It looked like it though, didn't it?
It did. I'll get to that in a second, but let's get just down to some figures at this point. We know that the blast, the explosion, because obviously when it enters the atmosphere, breaks apart. There's an explosion, yes. Apparently, the windows have been shattered and doors were flying out, and all in all, 300 buildings have sustained.
We believe, though we cannot yet prove, that our multiverse universe is 11 dimensional.
Now, wormholes are predicted by mathematical calculations. It certainly seems to be theoretically possible.
Universe in different dimensions, floating in a much larger arena. This larger arena is the hyperspace that I talked about originally.
Entrada a la ciudad de la Inca de Machu Picchu.
If you look at the trees, it's right here. I mean, it's 300 foot up.
It's very intense, bright lights. I keep hearing that over and over and over, and they spanned a wide area.
Just when you thought there could not be more change going on in the world, magnetic north is moving. Aviators know it has always moved, but not like this. It's just skipping along. It's on the move about 40 miles a year now along the polar cap toward Russia.
Well, hey, get used to it. Einstein was wrong.
Well, a major announcement today by NASA that a new form of life has been discovered right here on Earth.
Where they come from, I don't know. But it's one thing I know for sure. They've landed on Earth, and they've come among us.
They keep us homeless. We can't even get a job.
Before too long, the evidence will be incontrovertible that you will have on your TV screens and on your movie screens concrete evidence.
We are infected with a lot of them around here, especially here, around here, and everywhere we look at.
And that they are real, and they're not fantastic things which have been cooked up to make a movie.
The isolation other people in population, and then they dope you up.
Thanks, you are a human alien.
I don't feel like I belong here.
The unrest is being caused by thugs. They're hired by the system to turn the public against the immigrants. I say fuck money.
Is the job market drying up as a result of this?
Many a job. They're taking teenage jobs, double jobs, anything.
You better be ready to protect yourself. Because it's one thing I don't understand. what they want.
You're going to see all going to change. They know the gig is up.
You're encouraging a violent confrontation from people that have done nothing wrong.
The police and any authority, they make you feel like aliens.
Not good. It's not good at all.
One of my friends just disappeared. I think he was abducted.
Pretty soon, there ain't going to be any human.
Like creatures crawling around in.
They try to make it seem like it's just a horror movie, but it's really not a horror movie. It's really an actual thing, and they use that as a cover up.
From LA, from Hollywood to come.
How long they been here, what they been doing, unexplainable.
I think the government ain't doing nothing to prevent this, and I also believe that they're covering it up with medication.
You never ask a system to teach you values, because the values of the system is all cover up.
I'm telling you, the system has everyone in their pocket.
They look like us, and they're among us. For all I know, you could be one.
Then they're going to try to cover it up, and then they're going to try to bring it out.
Videotaping us, letting your society know this is what's going on Earth.
They're watching us.
Aí. Epa, mas a gente tem que ir quando a gente não, porque é doido, é? Não, peraí, falei umas confusão aqui, né? Não esquenta não. Bicho, vi uma parada ali passando atrás, bicho. Vocês viram? Não, deixa quieto, bom, continuar, acho que é frescura, né? Não, peraí, não, esquenta não. Pois é, continua aí. Caralho, bicho, tu viu, Leandro?
Eu vi!
Bicho!
Hello, can you hear me? Good. We are all interdimensional travelers, but you have forgotten this. The governments in control of your world have taken this knowledge from you, through the schooling system, through the mass media, through the religious system. We have been sent here to remind you of who you are. Please keep this link clear for further updates. End message.
Hi everybody. It's me, Lisa. And I'm excited to do another video with you, and I'm hoping the volume turns out well, otherwise I will have to use a headset. I'm in the hotel lobby right now because it seems to be the most lit place to be. Not real sure about taking the laptop out on the grounds. I might have to do that in a little while. It's been quite interesting, quite amazing. Every moment is. But then again, when you remember, when you no longer allow yourself to forget, when you come to exist in the fifth dimension inside, then that out there is a created projection from inside of you. It's already been created. You just have to step into the frequency where it exists. There is so much to share. I feel like I have not shared in months, but yet I'm sure if I look back it will only be a few weeks. I know that I post the energy reports as much as I have access to the internet, either by my phone or my computer. This Saturday I will move to a room, share. I have rented a room for 3 weeks. And then after that, I will flow to the next place that is meant to be. I go out most days and just meet people, just interact, just communicate and just connect. The people here don't know what to make of me. They don't know whether I am a lost tourist or a person with a backpack that is seeking a different or seeking a home. Those that roam the island with their backpacks stare at me trying to figure me out. Those that are tourists, they don't really care. And those that are islanders are not quite sure. I kind of stick out here, which is pretty typical and quite fun. So anyway, since I have arrived, it has been an amazing experience. Every moment allowed to come forth as it needs to be, being placed where I need to be, in the moment that I need to be, to connect with that which I need to see. I am looking forward to many exchanges in the upcoming days, weeks, moments, time combines to be just one moment, so technically the separation of time inside of me no longer exists. There are many changes coming, many amazing rememberings for those who have been seeking. All you have to do is open your heart and let go of everything that is not love, that is not light, the light activations that are occurring each day. Wow, they are exquisite. If there is any dent, they do not tend to seem to be this way. For those who have let go of duality inside, light just amps up the frequency, amps up the volume of that which we transmit. The activated Merkaba. When one is in tune as a cosmic portal inside, in frequency, they can hear this, they can see this, open-eyed, no longer in just a closed-eyed state. We started out having to sleep, to integrate, to merge, to flip realities, and then realities flip. Then the old human reality clears in our sleep, and our waking reality is like walking in a dream. It's magical. That is because we have always existed here. We had just forgotten. The magic never goes away. We do have to remember for a while to expect magic, because we already exist here. And then magic is in every breath that we take. For it is our natural way of being. It isn't magic anymore. It's what we've always known. It's out. It's always been. And we're home inside. And where our physical body doesn't tend to matter where it is, because home exists inside of us. And when we achieve that frequency inside, when we come home inside, then we can go anywhere we desire, and we're home. For me, apparently, now I remember, but I didn't at the time. I had been speaking of, I was going to, as a child, here in my human self. I used to tell everybody, when I grow up, I'm going to live in Hawaii. I said this relentlessly. I do remember it now. But I had forgotten, because I had so many human experiences that covered up. Amazing. That I had to dig and weed it through them and clear them and let them go until I could remember. And then magic came back. And then when I told my son I was going to Hawaii, he's like, "Mama, you've been saying that since I was a child." "Really?" "Yeah, really, Mama." In the last few years, I kept speaking of going to Hawaii. "I'm going to Hawaii." But I was never ready inside. I kept getting, "Just wait," inside. My higher self kept telling me, "Just wait. It's not time yet." So I waited. And then one day, I opened a portal inside of me. And it all came back. And I knew, now it's time. Now the thing about it is, I did not know anything. I just knew. And that was enough. When I got ready to come, I had a veil in place. I couldn't remember anything. I just was told, "Just arrive. It's all ready. You just have to achieve. You had to achieve the frequency inside. Just go." So I did. No preparation. No safe. There is no safe here. That is the human way. We step in faith in every moment. We trust. Because we know. It already is. So, I just wanted to stop by and say, I love you. I'm very honored to share with you And I know this video didn't really have a purpose, but that's okay. I just wanted to say hi. I wanted to honor you. I wanted to say thank you. And I look forward to more on this journey, because I shall be videotaping every time I have an opportunity. I shall be taking tons of photos and sharing and bringing you along the way. I shall be riding the bus more, and where a ride presents, I'll be going to some awesome sites. Until then, I'll be out meeting people at every moment, connecting. I'll be doing light body energy. I'll help wherever I can find the help. I'll do my sessions from here. I'll do workshops. I'll write the books. I have some great, amazing books that I have received. And I'm to start them next week, I'm told. So, here we go. Are you ready? Let's do this. I love you. Light activations, Merkaba, fifth dimension, all the way. Bye. Bye.